What's good, everyone? This is Jimmy. I'm just kidding, man. Every NBA season is a new opportunity. An opportunity for teams and players to prove to the masses what they're really all about. In the NBA, players have the ability to display their growth as well as their regression throughout their entire career. This can include showing off new skills they've acquired or simply showing how they've aged over time. Now, in the past, I have usually done straight up top 50 lists, live streaming them so that I can actually have a panel of people decide and debate on the order of the players. However, my longtime subscribers will know that I actually don't like ranking lists as they cause unnecessary debate and too much nitpicking that ends up as just hate and unfair criticism because of small details. I have been a longtime believer in tiers because if we're keeping it real, that's what we really should be using. Now, tier lists have caught on fire the past couple of months in social media, and fellow NBA YouTuber Jimmy Highroller actually made a video a couple months ago on his all-time NBA pyramid, which I felt was a very well thought out list, and his reasonings were extremely valid. While I may not have personally agreed with some of his choices, it was a great video that was centered around an interesting concept. I decided to put my own spin on this concept, instead focusing on current NBA players. There will be 7 tiers to this pyramid, starting at the bottom from tier 7, eventually working our way up to the top tier. Some key notes to take: I will be excluding players who missed a lot of last season, such as Kristaps Porzingis, Kevin Love, Victor Oladipo, and John Wall, just because I don't know exactly how good they are in relation to everyone else, since they missed so much of the recent season. That being said, I wanted to make as many players visible in one look, so there will be some color coding done to the graphic instead of just straight rows, because you really wouldn't be able to see all the players if I did this the traditional way. Also, the bottom tiers may include more players than actually mentioned because of this as well. In short, to really get this graphic, you really do have to watch the video for it to make sense, and also just listen to what the criteria is for each tier, because once again, I may miss some players that can be included in the bottom tier specifically. But without further ado, let's start off with tier 7. Tier 7 consists of players that are more than just role players, but I wouldn't consider a star. These are players that are important to playoff teams, however in most cases simply can't be the second best player on a playoff team. These players include Steven Adams, DeAndre Jordan, Al Horford, Clint Capella, Brook Lopez, Bojan Bogdanovic, Yusuf Nurkic, Andre Drummond, and Paul Millsap. The way the NBA is set up, this tier just naturally has a lot of big men, since most teams prioritize building around guards and wings more than big men these days. Next up, we have tier 6, the tier consisting of the future stars of the league. Now, this tier is a very confusing tier. These are players who have the potential to be tier 5 and up. Their talent level as of right now, however, are closer to tier 5 territory. However, because of their lack of playoff experience and development, it makes their value to a team right now closer to tier 7. However, again, because of their potential and age, teams are building around them like they're tier 4 players. These players consist of Zion Williamson, Brandon Ingram, Jason Tatum, Jaylen Brown, Buddy Hield, Montrezl Harrell, De'Aaron Fox, Trae Young, Luka Doncic, Kyle Kuzma, Jaren Jackson. You kind of get my drift, and the list goes on and on. And obviously, the latest draft class this year will welcome more members aside from Zion, like Ja Morant. It's a very weird tier, I know that. But I thought it'd be best to give the young players their own tier, since we really just don't know how good these players actually are because of the lack of sample size. We just know they're good right now and are gonna continue to be good and improve. Next up, we have tier 5. And tier 5 consists of players that many would agree can be the second best player on a playoff team, but not much more than that. Some may argue that the players I included can be more than that. Heck, some of these players are still developing and definitely have the potential to be more than that. In a perfect world where I fully dedicated myself to being 100% accurate and precise, I would divide this tier and the tiers above it into sub-tiers. As for example, in this tier, some of these players can be the second best player on a championship team, and some can only be the second best player on a 5-8 seed. Regardless, these are the players that I believe deserve to be in this tier. Kyle Lowry, Chris Middleton, Mike Conley, Zach LaVine, Lou Williams, LaMarcus Aldridge, Chris Paul, Jamal Murray, Draymond Green, Pascal Siakam, Tobias Harris, Drew Holiday, and Danilo Gallinari. Now you might be wondering, B-Souls, why didn't you put guys like Jamal Murray and Pascal Siakam in Tier 6? While still being extremely young, they have proven a lot in this year's playoffs, and there are certain cases where you don't need much experience to see how good someone is relative to everyone else. Just like you didn't need to wait 4 to 5 years to see how LeBron was better than Carlos Boozer. You could have made that assumption after his second year, and the same goes here, just on a smaller scale. Going into Tier 4, this is a tier that consists of players that I'm confident can be the best player on a playoff team that's a low seed and are expected to be first round exits more often than not. Now, given the right circumstances, they can go deeper than the first round. However, again, more often than not, these are the expectations of a team that is being led by the players in this tier. Some of the players in this tier actually have yet to make the playoffs, such as Kemba Walker. Well, Kemba Walker hasn't made it in a while, at least. Karl-Anthony Towns and Devin Booker, but I found they were too talented to fit the Tier 5 criteria. Other players in this tier, such as Klay Thompson, CJ McCollum, and Bradley Beal, have not been fully the number one option on a playoff team, but again, I found them too talented to be in Tier 5, and I am confident that if built around properly, they can produce great results. The rest of this tier includes players such as Jimmy Butler, Russell Westbrook, Nikola Vucevic, D'Angelo Russell, DeMar DeRozan, Blake Griffin, Rudy Gobert, Ben Simmons, and Donovan Mitchell. Moving on to Tier 3, this is where I really had to start nitpicking. So Tier 3 players are players that I believe you can build a team around, and more often than not, you will go 2 rounds deep, potentially 3, but that would be considered overachieving, and more often than not, aren't expected to be a title contender with them at the helm. The players I decided to include are Paul George, Damian Lillard, Kyrie Irving, and Joel Embiid. Now again, this tier will probably be the start of the controversy in this video. Paul George has been a first round exit for 4 straight years now. But again, let's consider the concept of development. This past season, Paul George finished top 3 in MVP and Defensive Player of the Year voting, and considering that, this is the best he's ever been. And I just don't think it's right for me to put a player in the discussion for the MVP in the same tier as D'Angelo Russell, Devin Booker, and DeMar DeRozan, with all due respect. Now moving on to Damian Lillard, he is another player that, prior to this year, was a perennial first round exit. But again, let's consider development. While regular season-wise, Dame has been pretty much the same as he's been in the past, in the playoffs, he changed his whole legacy and made it all the way to the Western Conference Finals because of his heroics. Now, granted, he didn't perform the best in the second round, but if you watch the series, you know that he still made a lot of crucial baskets, and his presence alone did help CJ McCollum, the same way Steph Curry's presence helps Klay Thompson on the court. Again, in the conference finals, Damian did underperform, but let's keep it real, most people had the Blazers as a first round exit, and Dame, going into the Western Conference Finals, already proved himself enough. However, I do agree he could have performed better, even though it was against the Warriors. Moving on to Joel Embiid, he is a person that fits my criteria perfectly. Kyrie Irving, on the other hand, I do have to explain. Since technically, up to this point, he has only been the best player on a playoff team once, where he didn't perform that well in the first round against an Oladipo-less Pacers team, and then massively underperformed in the second round. But let's put it this way. What I believe he showed in Cleveland as LeBron's second option was already good enough to put him in Tier 4. Since he's left Cleveland, he has gotten better in so many ways. He has become an above-average passer, he is a good off-ball player, he is the best he's ever been defensively, all while still being the deadly scorer he's always been. While yes, he did underperform this year with him at the helm, leading to conversations about the team being better without him. I still stand by the claim that the Celtics still would have been better if Kyrie was healthy in the 2018 playoffs and would have still made the Eastern Conference Finals, and if anything would have made the NBA Finals if Kyrie was healthy. Now with Gordon Hayward played as well, it might be a different story, but as I've stated throughout the season, the Celtics problem never just fell on Kyrie's shoulders. It was primarily a personnel problem, specifically with the amount of shot creators that they have. However, all of their problems definitely were not aided by Kyrie Irving, and he did not do much to help the cause. I am giving him the benefit of the doubt right now, but he is on the chopping block this year if he doesn't prove his doubters wrong. Now let's keep it moving and go to tier 2. And this tier includes players that I believe you can build a title contender around, however have not proven that you can actually win the whole thing with them at the helm. The players I decided to include are Nikola Jokic, James Harden, Giannis Antetokounmpo, and Anthony Davis. James Harden and Giannis are self-explanatory when it comes to this tier, however Nikola Jokic and Anthony Davis may not. Now you might be thinking, Damian Lillard led the Blazers past Jokic and the Nuggets, didn't even perform that well, yet is a tier under him, and that just logically makes little sense. The way I look at Nikola Jokic is, at age 24, this man led the Nuggets to the second best record in the Western Conference, was one game away from a conference finals berth, while averaging 25 points, 13 rebounds, and 8 assists on 50-40-85 splits in the playoffs. I just don't know how you can look at that and say you can't build a title contending team around that, considering that he will probably continue to improve from here on out. As far as Anthony Davis, again the track record shows that he's only gotten out of the first round once in his career. So why is he on this tier? The reason is I am giving him the benefit of the doubt, just because I feel like he is too talented to be in tier 3, and I do believe he has the ability to be the best player on a title contender. He just hasn't had the talent to prove so far in his career. And the one time he did, he just had to run into a fully healthy Warriors squad in the second round. So that is tier 2. And last, but certainly not least, we have tier 1. Now tier 1 consists of players that have indeed proven that you can build a championship team around them and can continue to do so for the next 2, 3, 4 years. These players being LeBron James of the Los Angeles Lakers, Stephen Curry of the Golden State Warriors, Kevin Durant of the Brooklyn Nets, and Kawhi Leonard of the Los Angeles Clippers. All four of these players have proven that you can win a championship around them, and it really doesn't get any better than these four players in the NBA. But now that we have gone through all 7 tiers, here is the finished product. Go ahead and take your screenshots right now. I will be open for questions in the back after this video. Now, some of the reasoning is not perfect, and I'm 100% sure I'll be looking back at this video a year from now, and I will be laughing my ass off as to how wrong I was. But to future me, just know that for the most part, as of early 2019, these rankings are justified. Let me know in the comment section what y'all think about my pyramid. Again, shout out to Jimmy High Roller for being the inspiration for this video. And also big shout out to my man Walter on Twitter for hooking me up with this graphic design that I use for the majority of this video. Really great guy, really easy to work with. Go ahead, check him out on Twitter. Again, shout out to him again. But with that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I am out. Peace.